Welcome friends to today's session of Life Lectures. For today's session of lectures, we have with us in our studio Dr. Shruti Vip. Dr. Vip is assistant professor in PGDAV Evening College, Delhi University. She has a very great insight into history of women studies. So today's topic of discussion is history of feminism, where we are going to discuss different phases of women education, feminisms, and how women movements have evolved over a period of time, with a special emphasis on French, a reference to French Revolution. So friends, we want to confirm you that if you have any questions regarding this session, you can call us on our toll-free number in last 10 minutes of this session. For that, please note our toll-free number, which is 1-800-110-430. Now let's welcome Dr. Vip and let's start with today's topic. We welcome you, Dr. Vip, and let's start with today's topic.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for the opportunity. As I had discussed in the last lecture, which was the beginning of a new series, that was an introductory lecture, and continuing from there, in today's lecture, I would be talking about history of feminism and also some reference to the discipline of gender studies and how women's movement evolved, not during a 20th century, but much before than that. And in fact, one needs to take into account, you know, the last few decades of 18th century, and French Revolution played a very important role in exposing a whole new range of ideas to women, and also to all those who wanted to bring about a change in society. So continuing with our discussion on the discipline of gender studies basically examines how gender is less determined by nature than it is by culture, and therefore it involves some kind of a cultural analysis rather than only a political or an economic analysis. And it is this cultural analysis which is at the center of the most complex and critical analysis, which is quite rampant in contemporary times. Now gender history, when we talk about that, this does not really mean that we are only going to talk about post World War I era, or we are only going to talk about the times once the Industrial Revolution started. In fact, it means the whole new, the complete range of historical incidents, developments that took place from 18th century onwards, and this also is associated with postmodernism. So gender identities are fluid and historical, and they keep on changing over a period of time, and one cannot really talk about a particular kind of status of women as having existed during particular periods. Against the biological determinism, nothing about the body determines univocally how social divisions will be shaped. So therefore, gender history, the most important premise of gender history is that it refutes biological determinism. It does not really accept the logic of biology, that women are, they are born with certain features, and their physical features have great limitations. So therefore, they cannot really achieve many things in life which are just not allowed biologically for them. And this kind of analysis was developed by Joan Scott in the famous work, Gender, a Useful Category of Historical Analysis. Another very important theme, which is very common in gender studies, is the theme of masculinity. So therefore, gender studies does not really only talk about femininity, and in fact gender historians are interested equally in the study of masculinity, because masculinities vary across space and time, and a relationship between masculinity and femininity is considered to be very important and worth, you know, studying and analyzing, and a critical appraisal is very important theme behind any kind of gender study. So, how women stand in relation to men, and to the, understand this this paradigm, it is very important to talk about both masculinity and femininity, and not disrespect one for the sake of understanding the other in a better way. In order to understand the history of women's movement, it would be worthwhile to take a journey to revolutionary France, that is the time from 1789 onwards, when the French Revolution started. Now, the French Revolution was a process. It was not an event which would have begun or ended within a few months of 1789. Rather than this, it was a long drawn out process and a struggle. And during this entire period of the revolutionary struggle, which continued well in till the time of Napoleon, and then again after that, the history of French Republic started. Now, during this course of struggle, one needs to take into account the kind of changes that were brought about, the kind of constitutional developments that happened, the new laws that were promulgated, and how they give an insight to the changes that were going to come in the lives of women. So, a very important law that came into being in September 1792 was on divorce, and women were allowed to control family property after French Revolution, and laws pertaining to this were also promulgated. Then another very important law that came into being was in 1792 itself, which is known as Law of 2nd November 1792, which it declared that there are no more bastards, which means that the whole issue of legitimacy, a legitimate or an illegitimate child, they were adhered to. While all these developments were taking place, and women were taking part actively in marches, in food riots, and in raising demands, and in also opposing royalty, in also raising slogans, etc. With the coming of Napoleon and with the promulgation of Napoleonic Civil Code in 1804, there was a big question mark as far as the status of women was concerned. As a very important a statement of the Napoleonic Civil Code of 1804 was, the husband owes his wife protection, the wife owes her husband obedience. So, you can well imagine that how very rigidly lines were drawn, and it was expected of the wife to remain obedient and subservient to the male partner, while it was the duty of the husband to provide protection. So, therefore, the role models were clear cut for both husband and wife. Now, another development that took place in 19th century France was slow and gradual replication of the cult of domesticity. So, while there was a change, a political change that had come about, and also industrial revolution which had started in Great Britain by the end of 18th century, and it had begun to impact some other countries of Europe also, and France also started experiencing a change in the form of expansion of factories, etc. So, this dichotomy between the public and the private sphere got further hardened, and the idea that was projected was that women should be seen as angels of the hearth. Hearth here means the domestic space, the kitchen, the kitchen fire, and how they could it was only they who could be in true command of the home front. An ultra royalist, Louis de Runald, pointed out that women understand better than men how to run domestic affairs, which proves better than lengthy arguments that nature does not summon them to control public affairs. So therefore, the underlying idea behind such statements, and there were many such statements during 19th century France, which clearly indicated a very limited kind of a domestic role for women, because they were cut out for those roles, and they no one else could take care of the domestic affairs better than better than the females. So therefore, it was expected that they should remain happy and satisfied performing their domestic roles, and this would also give lot of satisfaction and strength to men who were fighting on the fronts. So, the kind of republican views on women that emerged from time to time in France, for example, republican men viewed themselves as rational, self-controlled and citizens, whereas these features and these definitions were not to be assigned to women, because they were neither considered rational and nor were they considered in control or in command. They were considered as emotional, one who would give in to their desires, and therefore they lacked the very essence of being responsible citizens. And they also stressed that the woman's place was in the home, looking after her husband and family. So therefore, the role of a mother educator was clearly becoming very important, and this also had the legacy of Napoleonic civil code, which clearly demarcated the roles that the family had to play in French society, and that too the women of family, especially the mother, how important it was for the mother to be educated in order to educate the children and in order to make them responsible citizens. So with that limited vision, the French the French Republic started talking about women. Then another very important statement that was made was that every wife who is truly a wife has for a career the career of her husband, and with these kind of remarks, the desire of French women who had participated in the revolution and who were actively looking at the French state, who had great dreams and demands of political participation, all that was nipped in the bud. Now coming to the era of 1848 revolution. Now this also was a very important period, not only in French history but in history of most of the European countries, because this was a time when monarchy was all the more weakened, and the reign of it was declared that the reign of brute force is past, it is over, that is the autocratic regimes of the world should come to an end, and the one of morality and intelligence is beginning. So this was the kind of fervor which was behind the revolutions of 1848. The reasons that led our fathers to exclude women from all participation in government no longer have any value today. Now, this was another statement that was made in the course of 1848 revolution. The realization that women also had a right to participate, and that right must be respected, and it was wrong in a way to neglect that right so far. So therefore, the statement that was made was that women must be called upon to participate in the great work of social regeneration that is preparing itself. So these were the kind of revolutionary ideas that started taking grounds in the course of the 1848 revolution, and the image that was now portrayed was the new women. Now who were the new women? The new women was most commonly represented as a dangerous creature, who was highly masculinized, but she was also man-hating, and she was too much emancipated politically as well as sexually, and she was so much of a pervert. She was so much of a pervert that she could not see the natural order of things and a threat to majority and to civilization itself. So therefore, with these kind of statements also being made, along with the realization that women needed more rights in the course of 1848 revolution, they tell us that how there was a lot of dichotomy which was there in the philosophies that were current in those times. That while on the one hand it was being considered that probably women needed more rights, but at the same time the image that was being projected of the highly liberated women was one full of negativity and perversion. Now, another very important theme that came to be associated with women from 1850s onwards was the expansion of education. Republican expansion of education, especially in the 1870s and 1880s, for example, a law that was introduced was the Camel-Sees Law of 1880, which introduced female secondary schools. Prior to this, female secondary education was not really very well developed in France. Then more women started entering university, because the next logical step after secondary education was of course higher education, and almost 2,772 French women enrolled at the universities by 1911 to 1912, and this was a 20-fold increase from the earlier period of 1889 to 90. So gradually it was being realized that it was important to give education, and especially secondary and higher education, to women also, if one had to prepare them for the new roles of citizens. Now, as these developments were going on, the next logical step was, of course, job-oriented women and professional women, and there were around 57,000 female teachers by 1906, and most of the educated French women started taking to profession. In fact, it was 50% of the educated French women who started looking for a profession, and not only sitting at home after completing their education. And various office and clerical works, banks, railway companies, etc., were important avenues. And in fact, by 1914, 30% of the female workforce was employed not only in offices but also in departmental stores, in medical facilities, etc. So therefore, the kind of feminism that one can talk about for this period, one can give a reference to the gradualist and liberal kind of feminism, which could best advance by making small dents in the hard wall that patriarchy had constructed against women's claims. So the idea was not to bring about a sudden cataclysmic revolution or to start demanding immediate solution to the problem, but rather diplomatically handle the situation and only make small dents in the hard wall of patriarchy. And the feminists' task was to locate the loose brick and hammer against it, and this was considered as real politic also, that is, to intelligently deal with the situation of deprivation and not to ask for things that were not possible to be done in immediate future. So now another idea that had started maturing in France was that while women were getting educated, they were becoming professionally qualified, they had also started working, but the idea was that women were still not considered ready for the vote. And there were various philosophers and thinkers like Richer who were of this opinion. For example, Richer pointed out, "I believe that at the present time it would be dangerous in France to give women the political ballot. They are in great majority and they are mostly reactionaries and clericals. If they voted today, the Republic would not last 6 months. So there were a lot of doubts and it was not really considered safe to give voting rights to women, because it was considered that they were not rational beings, they were reactionaries, they were under the influence of clericals, and if they would participate politically, then this would bring about the weakening of the Republic, and this kind of weakening of Republic could not be afforded, because France had to remain strong, it had to remain, you know, a strong masculinized nation who could keep fighting wars at the front and also keep winning them. Then another very important statement that was made in 1876 by Auclert shows that how educated French women were feeling deprived. The statement runs like this: in spite of the benefits that came from our revolution of 1789, women have no rights. As interested as we may be in the happiness of our country, we are pitilessly turned away from all meetings, whether elective or legislative. So this was the kind of thoughts. These were the kind of thoughts that were coming to the minds of women, and which they were sharing, that how the French Revolution had not really been a revolution in true sense of the term, and how even though they had participated wholeheartedly and they had sacrificed their lives and had gone through so much of hardship, they were just turned away from the meetings because they were just not considered as worthy of participating in them. And in fact, they women also pointed out that how intelligent women also suffered even if they were compared with stupid and ignorant men, because just by being a man, it is so virtuous in France to be a man that a stupid man also counts for more in France than the best educated woman. So any kind of man, whether intelligent or unintelligent, can can name his legislators, that is, they can select the legislators, they can participate in the voting process, whereas the most intelligent woman also cannot do that. So she is a creature apart who is born with many duties and no rights. So this realization that French women had only duties and they had no rights was gradually dawning upon women, and soon a time was to come when French feminism would emerge and arise and there would be no looking back. So now, having discussed these various aspects, now we would be talking about the achievements of French feminism by 1914, and how before on the eve of the First World War, what was the status of women. Now I shall take a short break here and then resume with these points in the next lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vip. We would like to we would take a short break here and we'll continue with history of feminism, and as been stated by Dr. Vip, that achievements of feminism by 1914, we'll be discussing it. We would like to remind you, if you have any questions regarding this session, you may call us in last 10 minutes of this session on our toll free number, which is 1-800-110-430. We'll be back after a short break.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back, friends, to the second half of the lecture. Prior to this, we were talking about, we ended in the achievements of French feminism by 1914, and Dr. Whip is about to discuss that with you all. We'd like to tell you, if you have any questions regarding this session, you may call us in last 10 minutes of the session on our toll-free number, which is 1-800-110-430. Let's welcome Dr. Whip and let's continue with today's topic of history of feminism. We welcome back you again, Dr. Whip, and let's discuss the topic once again.
Thanks a lot. So talking about the achievements of French feminism, as so much of struggle had taken place and the process had started from French Revolution itself, as we had discussed just now. So what all had been achieved by 1914? Sadly, no vote for women, but married women were allowed to dispose of their own incomes by 1908. And by 1912, paternity suits were allowed. Before that, even this was not allowed in revolutionary France. And then another important change that came about was to raise the issue of women's rights as to how more and more rights could be assigned to women and how what all changes that needed to be there in society, and also not only at the level of family but also at the level of the public sphere. However, a constant theme that was running parallel during the 19th century as well as the beginning of 20th century was the threat of masculinity, the French masculinity, which was considered under threat. And this happened specially due to defeat to Prussia in 1870, and this traditional Franco-Prussian rivalry and France's engagements in various wars and its defeat in on the war frontiers, this shook the confidence of the middle class Frenchmen. So therefore, there was all the more a reluctance to share powers and authority with the other sex. French men feared deep down that foreigners saw them as lacking in the honor and warrior-like virility, which was still believed to embody masculinity itself. So therefore, there was a further hardening of stance and this further creation of binaries between masculinity and femininity, which refused to share power with women. Now, having discussed this, I would now like to talk about the various waves of women's liberation movements. As already discussed, one can talk about three waves of the women's liberation movements, of course, with a number of strands within each movement. So from 19th to earlier 20th century can be considered as the first wave of women's liberation movement, where the main goal was the demand for political equality and the right to work. This was basically the right to vote and the right to work, which was important during this period. And from 1960s to 1980s, one can talk about the second wave of women's liberation movements, where the main goal was social and cultural equality. So therefore, the whole issue of social status as well as the whole issue of culturally uplifting women and also refusing to abide by age-old socio-cultural norms became very important. And from 1990s onwards, one can talk about the third wave of feminism, which is the continuing struggle for social, political, economic, cultural equality. Now, in the most basic sense, the political democracies began to appear in the world only with the extension of political rights to women in the early 20th century. And it was not as if all the countries got right to vote for women during early 20th century. Here also there were many divergences. The labor movements and the socialist parties played a key role in the struggle for women's rights. So therefore, there was this grand alliance between the feminist movements as well as the labor movements and the socialist parties, which played a very important role in bringing about this, in raising the demand for justice and also demanding equitable political rights for women. Now, a very important contribution in this was made by August Bebel. August Bebel was, you know, the leader of German Social Democratic Party, and in his famous work, Women and Socialism, that came out in 1883, Bebel wrote, "Every socialist recognizes the dependence of the workman on the capitalist and cannot understand that others, and especially the capitalists themselves, should fail to recognize it also. But the same socialist often does not recognize the dependence of women on men because the question touches his own dear self more or less nearly." So therefore, here Bebel talks about how there was a need for the workers, for the peasants, for the working men to realize the importance of bringing about more rights and to empower women. Now, another very important contribution in this regard was made by Clara Zetkin, who was a German socialist feminist. She also raised the issues of women's political and economic rights and refused to abide by the contemporary political discourse. Then another important development that took place was the demand for voting rights in New York, and how the women's suffrage march, as you can see on this slide, in on May 1913 became instrumental, and many women rallied behind this demand for voting rights. Now, suffrage or the right to vote in the US saw a journey that, you know, continued for more than 100 years. So, while in 1776, the landed white men over 21 had got right to vote, all those who owned the real estate, only those men got right to vote. But for women, this right came much later, and that was as late as 1920. So, while women were allowed to vote in UK in 1928, in Canada this right came around mid-1920s. Then a very important development that took place during the course of 20th century in the form of various revolutions, and also the Russian Revolution played a very important role in bringing about a more equitable approach towards women, and granting women the right to vote was a standard feature during most of these revolutions. So, as you can see on the slide of Russia, the March 1917, which shows a women's demonstration, and during this demonstration, the statement that was made was that voting rights are not universal if women don't have them. So, therefore, women started asserting themselves, and this started demanding voting rights for them, and they were not going to, you know, accept what was being given to them or what was being handed down to them by the strong states. Rather, they were going to raise their voice. Then another important Russian revolutionary and feminist leader from 1895 to 1926 was Reisner, who also talked about something more than voting rights, and who talked about how it was important to bring about the socio-cultural change also, and a change in the perspective of family planning and also domestic duties. Then, as a result of all these struggles and demands that were raised by women, the civil marriage registration took place in Russia from 1920s onwards, which again was a welcome change. And another important poster that I can share with you is the Soviet poster of 1920s. As you can see on this slide, the slogan was "Down with kitchen slavery." So now Russian women began raising their voice against their kitchen slavery and how they were expected to cook day in and day out while men were busy outside homes. So they started raising their voices against this kind of backbreaking work, which was not really giving them any political power, nor it was socially or culturally empowering them. So they started comparing kitchen work to slavery, and they started ridiculing this kind of a stereotyping that was still going on in revolutionary Russia. A number of images that started cropping up was that how women could play some very important roles which were far more active, and they could assist men, they could participate on the war front, they could play the role of nurses, doctors, and they could play far more active and non-traditional, non-stereotypical roles on the war front. And a number of Soviet women, they became pilots, and they participated in a big way during the Second World War. So this was the kind of change that was visualized and that was being talked of. Now here it is important to discuss the differences between different waves of feminism also, as I just mentioned the three waves of feminism, but it was not as if all the three waves they were similar or they were completely different from each other. In fact, there were many similarities, but there were some differences as well. And in fact, one wave had a lot to owe to the preceding wave. So the first wave of feminism was principally concerned with women's material disadvantages compared to men. By material disadvantages, I mean to say their economic status, and they were focused on the social, political and economic reform of the society. So these were the kind of different demands that were raised from time to time. And the second wave of feminism focused more on the politics of reproduction, on the issue of women's experience, sexual difference, sexuality, both as a form of oppression and also as something to celebrate. So therefore now, rather than only talking about socio-political economic rights, there was more emphasis on culture, there was more emphasis on sexuality and the celebration of women's sexuality rather than trying to become like men. So therefore, this was a more mature phase, and this was the natural corollary of the preceding phase. Now, if we talk about the third world feminist movement, this was largely the movement which took place in those areas which were in the developing world, and these were the erstwhile colonies where the developed world had established their colonies, ruled over them for two or more centuries. And then there was after independence in these areas, there was a realization that how the kind of feminist politics that had evolved in the developed world was not really suitable to them, and in fact they needed to arise and awake differently. So they questioned the politics of universalism. So they refused to abide by the logic of a universal feminist movement on a or a universal race of womanhood. So therefore, the feminist movements in the third world talked about the current controls and the misrepresentations that had been going on since the past, and how the colonial regimes in these countries had continued to replicate the kind of patriarchal institutions that they had inherited, rather than bringing about a change or reforming to the true sense of the term. then they also questioned the whole idea of homogeneity. You know, they talked about the different categories that exist in the form of race, caste, class, community, religion, and how there was a need to analyze the category of gender through the prism of these different institutions rather than describing homogeneity in the women's movement. So, therefore, the features of the third world feminist criticism are very important to understand, and there was a lot of influence on the literature also of these kind of feminist criticisms that were taking shape. So, one was the focus on place and displacement. So, therefore, the context became very important. It was in this regard that the feminists in these areas pointed out that how their experiences and their level of deprivation was quite different from what the Western societies had gone through. They questioned the model of otherness. This very model had been replicated by the Western civilization, and the whole idea of the duty of the West towards the East and their authority and their reform mindedness, which motivated them to bring about greater equality in the Oriental societies, was questioned. Then the focus on myth, allegory, and the use of untranslated words, this also was brought to the knowledge, and that how it was important to study the myth and to study the whole tradition of the Oriental countries in order to understand the origin of patriarchy, and also to understand the whole process with reference to the context, and the refusal to create a hierarchy of texts, that only those texts that or only that kind of knowledge that had been introduced by the Western civilization was the ultimate, and rest of the knowledge the textual tradition was not as important. So, refusal to accept that was also one of the important themes. A question that arises here is that how can we avoid creating monolithic images of women like veiled women, the powerful mother, the chaste virgin, and the obedient wife. Now, these are the very images that one comes across not only in the colonial literature, but also in the post-colonial literature and in the post-colonial philosophical and also political discourse. So, therefore, the idea of the powerful mother does not really mean powerful woman, because the woman's role here is being limited to being a mother. A woman can be powerful only if she is a mother. So, no one says that a powerful woman. Women need to be powerful mothers so that they can raise powerful citizens, they can raise masculine sons, and so by doing this they are doing great service to the nation. Similarly, the epithet the obedient wife, again wife on its own terms, and of an independent wife or a powerful wife is no longer a term that is used. It was never used, because a wife has to be obedient so that the family continues with the kind of tradition and respectability and the kind of stereotypical role that has been assigned to women in an unquestioned manner. So, therefore, the differences between different kind of feminisms and in different kind of contexts becomes very important, and this has been explored largely in contemporary times. Now, another important theme that one can talk about with reference to feminism is the concept of transnational feminism and global feminism. Now, on its face value, you would think that what is the difference between these two terms? Transnational is global. No, but here there is a difference in the kind of approach that is, that is working behind them. The term global feminism favors a universalized Western model of women's liberation that celebrates individuality as well as modernity. Now, here modernity needs to be understood with reference to certain parameters, and I have already discussed in detail the issue of modernity and how modernity in itself has its own problematic. So, I would request the audience to go back to the earlier lectures on modernity and women's rights, and things would become clearer. Now, the term transnational implies across borders. So, transnational recognizes inequalities which are arising out of women's differences that frame these border crossings. So, therefore, the term transnational is far more broader in its analysis, and it has far greater scope of accommodating differences. And transnational feminism is committed to activism that encourages dialogue for change rather than projecting universal images. So, therefore, transnational feminism avoids universalizing women in its rejection of a universal sisterhood and a universal notion of patriarchy. So, therefore, the transnational feminism is a far more modern, broader, approach to study feminism, because first of all, it rejects the idea of universal sisterhood. That is, women across the world are united and they have a common set of problems. This is not true, because women in the developed countries definitely do not have the kind of problems that are faced by a caste-ridden and a marginalized community staying in a developing country. And also the notion of patriarchy is different. So, while patriarchy might be existing in the developed world, but the kind of patriarchal institutions with the kind of traditions that are existing in a developing country, for example, India, are completely different from the kind of ones that are existing in, say, for example, US or UK. Now, with this kind of approach, a fresh insight that was made into studying women's history was recasting women. Now, this has been a very interesting and insightful kind of collection of works on women's contribution to history writing, and Kumkum Sangari and Sudesh Vaid in Recasting Women, an Introduction. In this work, Sangari asserts that if feminism is to be different, it must acknowledge the ideological and problematic significance of its own past. So, therefore, a lot of importance in this work has been laid to the current categories of difference and deprivation and exploitation, but by giving importance to the historical context also. So, therefore, an analysis of marginalized groups, caste, class, religion, community, language, all this has been done with specific reference to gender binaries as well as with specific reference to history, you know, different periods of history, and especially how the colonial period created the kind of stage in which it was not only the colonial regime which was participating and trying to create a patriarchal state, but even the indigenous male members of society, those belonging to the upper caste and class, also got an opportunity to have their own ways. A very important contribution to this regard was also made by Gayatri Spivak Chakravarti, related to the rise of feminisms among women of color is the area of post-colonial studies. So, Gayatri Spivak can be associated with the post-colonial studies, and Spivak examines the effects of political independence upon subaltern, upon the subproletarian women, in the third world countries. So by subaltern here, I mean to say the marginalized groups, the marginalized sections of the society, they could be women, they could be scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other marginalized groups as far as different categories of communities, language, region, etc. goes. So, therefore, according to Spivak, one needs to go beyond the universal, and rather one needs to look into these individual categories, and then only a truer image and a picture of gender inequality would emerge that would also be rich quite historically. Now, instead of creating yet another grand tradition or a cumulative history of emancipation, neither of which can deal with our contemporary problems, we need to be attentive to how the past enters differently into the consciousness of the historical. So, therefore, the idea is to reject the grand narrative and rather to take up issues in a piecemeal manner, and also to take into account different categories, specially related to the marginalized sections of society, in order to understand and in order to project the truer picture. And this is again, the idea is to take into consideration the categories of caste, class and gender, and then only a holistic picture can be devised. Now, having discussed these various issues, I would now like to conclude the lecture, and in the next lecture, we would be discussing the issues of equality and justice with a reference to the different phases of feminism. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vip. Thank you all for joining us for this session. We hope that you get a very great insight into the different phases of feminism and how women movement evolved over a period of time, with a special emphasis or reference at French movement. Friends, if you have any questions or suggestion regarding this session, you may mail us at on our mail ID, which is info.cec@nic.in. And thank you for joining us. We once again thank you, Dr. Webb, for giving us a great insight into the history of feminism. And we'll meet you again. Thank you, friends.